I have not spent a day without loving you. I have not spent a night without clasping you in my arms. I have not drunk a cup of tea without cursing the glory and ambition which keep me from the heart of my very being. In the midst of my activities, whether at the head of my troops or inspecting the camps, my adorable Josephine stands alone in my heart. She occupies my mind and fills my thoughts. This is a love letter from Napoleon to his beloved Josephine, whom he truly loved till the end, despite his numerous lovers, affairs, and divorce. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the podcast Life to Battlefield, and welcome all of you risk takers and truth seekers. My name is Mario Bekes, and today I'm going to talk about Josephine Bonaparte and Napoleon Bonaparte. It is very intriguing to speak about love between the woman and the man who is being marked as a tyrant. To the history, we have there so many examples. Napoleon, Caesar, Josephine and Napoleon. We have as well Gaddafi wife. The list goes on. But one thing what I learned on Intelligence Academy, it is how women can influence the men to give information. Today we're going to talk about how the women influenced men to conquer, to run the wars, to kill the millions. Even during Napoleon ruling, almost 3 million people perished during these campaigns and wars. So let's go talk today about Josephine Bonaparte and Napoleon Bonaparte. We need to touch how the first time they met. Napoleon was only 26 years old when he met Josephine, a young widow with two children, in 1795. Her husband, a French viscount, had been sentenced to death by what? Guillotine, the previous year, 1974. So, she was the girlfriend of several well-known politicians, and she was the companion of Paul Barras, who wanted to marry his expensive mistress with Napoleon since he couldn't sustain two mistresses. Now, she was ideal for the young General Bonaparte, who wanted to marry an affluent, mature, and serious aristocrat at the time. He stated, that's what Napoleon said, to the centuries, men or women they married because of the reason, because it was convenient. You know, the woman will marry the guy with the land, with the property, with the money, because it provides security, safety, and everything else. And the guy is like a Bonaparte. Well, he became the general under very different circumstances. So it doesn't come in from the very affluent family, very rich family. But marrying Josephine, well, that's something different. Well, so they met. Josephine met every his need. However, Napoleon fell in love unintentionally the first time they met at a party. Her charisma, intelligence, and impeccable taste drove him over. She, on the other hand, didn't like him a bit. But history writes the books. Josephine, who was rather extravagant and lived a luxury lifestyle, couldn't afford to give up the way of life for her or her children. She's become accustomed to. Out of curiosity, she agreed to his courtship and married him right immediately. You know, in those days, you send a letter. Today, you send a text and say, like, can I see you? I'd like to, you know, you accompany me for the cup of tea, for the sandwich, whatever it is. Let's go sit down a main square piazza, looking at executions of the people by guillotine, and let's go laugh, giggle, and fall in love. So she agreed. And what else? She married him. Well, that was a marriage for the sake of convenience. Neither her nor his families were in favor of this marriage. She was older. She already had two children, and it was doubtful whether she would be able to give the birth. And she had a reputation as a lady with questionable morals, who was prone to changing boyfriends on a regular basis. Despite this, she had certain social standing, was very liked by others, and she was skilled at forming alliances and making contacts with those in position of power. Her friends considered Napoleon to be lesser commander with a little money who was constantly on the battlefield, so he was being considered nothing. Napoleon had to travel quickly after his marriage since he was in love with Josephine and wanted to be constantly with his bride. He wrote her letters every day, full of adoration, love, and good words, and she responded that he loves her from afar. She continued to live a promiscuous life of sexual encounters, looking for reasons to join him. So she was looking for the reasons to join him, to be with him. So she wrote, "Because you weren't writing to your husband, oh my darling, that woos and those 4 days made me miss my previous apathy. My spirit is heavy, my heart is bound, and my fantasies disgust me. You love me less now, but you'll get over it. Say it. I'll know how to be worthy of this catastrophe when you no longer love me. Farewell, wife, anguish, joy, hope, and the beating heart of my being, whom I love and fear, and who inspire in me delicate sentiment that draw me near to nature, as well as passionate impulses as volcanic as Etna." Those are the words. He made love fast and hard. How he done this? He felt upset and decided to leave her after discovering how she behaves while he's away. And he was the last to learn. Can you imagine you living your life, happened today as well, somebody you love, somebody you cherish, somebody you're holding in your two hands, you know, you are certain that this person loves you. However, that person cheats on you, and you are the last person to find out. Happened to Napoleon, happens today. There's no difference. Everybody knows you're the last. Can you imagine how Napoleon felt? He did not choose to divorce her, but he did choose to overlook adulterous wife. Even so, the fickle Josephine was not happy. She was not happy. It wasn't until then that she began to miss him. She stopped cheating on him and decided to devote herself completely to him, making herself available to him at all times. Something changed. Even though he still loved her, he began to distance himself and began dating someone else at the moment. Aside from that, he adored and cared for her children. I didn't want to be without Josephine's ability to persuade others of what was best for him. So she was a great networker. She was also good at it. In his letters, he remained sensitive. "I'm well, you have my love and my yearning. In my opinion, there's only one woman in the world. My lone love, Josephine, is gentle, eccentric, and prone to rage. But she battles and handles everything with such elegance because she is so interesting." History says he was a passionate and brutal lover. Napoleon could love like a firefighter putting out a fire. According to Josephine, however, she made so much noise while having fun that her yells usually scared half the court. You know, the court, the people who live with them. Napoleon, he never ceased caring about her. For those who don't know, that Napoleon, he was a general, and then he became the emperor of France. So he was the leader of the one country. He was waging the war, conquering the continents entirely, exactly, the Austria, the Russia, the Balkans, you know, the Egypt. He was everywhere. However, days come to the end day marriage. Napoleon and Josephine divorced 5 years after she became empress. That cause was that she did not bear a child and leave an heir. He wanted to have the son. He wanted somebody to succeed him. Josephine found the explanation difficult to take, but she agreed to let Napoleon marry a younger woman who could bear him a heir. However, the ex-couple maintained a friendly relationship. Friendly. Her infertility is supposed to be the only thing standing between them. He gave Josephine and her children his whole attention until the end. So she influenced him even he was married to other women. She was granted permission to use the castle at the Mamasson, which is not far from Paris, and she began producing roses there. There were up to 250 different types of roses in her garden. "I want to see you," he wrote to her a few months after divorce. "I'll be in Malmaison at the end of the month because I'm dying to see you." Napoleon tells her, "I'm married, but I want to see you." Napoleon never stopped writing her love messages. He recognized at the end of his life that his new wife, the Austrian princess Matthias Louise, was helpful since she born him a son. But Josephine filled his life with a true love and was his unwavering support in everything. When she died, Napoleon wept for days. When somebody dies and we are sad, we're crying, there's a big difference. In Napoleon's case, don't forget, he was an alpha male. He conquered the continents. He conquered almost entire Europe, Egypt. He's going to Russia. And this guy, he was crying, and everybody saw, everybody knew it. So love for Josephine was even stronger than him being emperor. So how Josephine died? Josephine died of pneumonia 4 years after her divorce. Allegedly as a result of a cold she caught while strolling around the Malmaison gardens with who? Russian Emperor Alexander I. Now, did she caught pneumonia while she was walking with Russian Emperor or being poisoned? Well, history is going to judge, you know. We have the very, very much evidence that Russians love to pay you a visit with a cup of tea and the people become poisoned. At that stage, Napoleon was exiled to the island of Elba in the same month that she died. And he learned of her death while still fighting for his life. Napoleon then allegedly secluded himself in a room for 2 days, refusing to come out. The final words he whispered on his deathbed were Josephine. He wrote the violets she gave him as a necklace around his neck until his death. How strong that love was, how much she was influencing Napoleon Bonaparte, how strong Josephine she was as a networker, and how much she helped him to stay on the power. Let me know in the comment section below, what is a true love for you? Did you ever feel that that one woman, she was exactly that woman for you? Thank you for watching. Feel free to subscribe, share, like, and comment.